Beyond and hello and welcome once again to IGN's weekly PlayStation show. I'm your host, Max Scoville, and today we are checking in with some PS5 Pro early adopters about their experiences so far. Sony promises that they are not done with single-player games, and we should be looking forward to a whole bunch more of them. And speaking of which, the reviews are in for LEGO Horizon Adventures. We're going to be talking about all that and more coming up right now. Well, Beyond and hello, everybody. I'm joined once again by Jada Griffin, Akeem Lawanson, and Brian Altano. Beyond, hello.
Beyond.
Hey, Max. Beyond.
Hey, how's it going? How's everybody doing? We got some stuff to talk about. There's some big news.
There's some video games out there.
There's like a bunch of
about, I guess.
Wonderfully weird little tidbits. Jada, you just reviewed LEGO Horizon Adventures, and we're definitely gonna be talking about that in a little bit. More interestingly, I just right off the gate, I just want to give a heads up that Sony is doing a temporary price drop for the holidays of the PS5 Slim Digital Edition, which I believe is going down to $379.99, which is what's about like $70 cheaper than it was, something like that.
$70 cheaper, yeah, and $20 cheaper than it launched at because it got a $50 price increase at some point. So
there you go. If anybody
getting warmer, getting back to the OG price.
Yep. Elsewhere in the realm of PlayStation related holiday shopping guide stuff, there's this company called Rock Love that does like kind of nerdy jewelry, and they just announced a PlayStation line which has a bunch of, you know, little necklaces and rings and stuff based on PlayStation things,
pendants, bunch of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, this is probably not something I would wear, but like, I don't know, it could be a cute stocking stuffer or something like that. On a more, intense technical level, here's a weird one. Sony patented a new feature for a PlayStation controller, which would be a rewind button. And this is, I love that our cover art for this is just Adam Sandler from the film Click, which is like,
oh, yeah, that's our social team, baby.
Yeah, my go to here was like picturing a TV remote because of that. But obviously it would be a feature on a DualSense. And it describes this as a universal button on a controller that would activate when a universal button on a controller during live gameplay that would allow the user to see a series of images of frames of live gameplay. They can then scroll through like a rewind button, basically. But I'm guessing this is kind of more, you know, it sounds like it's pretty similar to the share button, like what we've already got. It's just more, you know, dipping back into your own clip.
Every day and every generation, we move closer to our controllers being looking like TV remotes. Every day we get closer and closer to them matching the button count.
That's true.
Just can't wait for it to have a numpad just on the controller.
I mean, when I saw this story, I immediately thought of, I believe this is an Xbox game, I thought of Blinks the Cat. So I was thinking like,
Blinks the Time Sweeper.
Yeah. Is it like that where you just rewind and you can redo whatever it is, or do an action differently, or how is that going to work?
I'm curious if it's going to. Oh, go ahead, Brian.
No, I was going to say, I think that it will be built in on like on an OS level, basically, and less more of a gameplay mechanic. Like Braid and Blinks both operated on that sort of rewind function. This to me is more like when you emulate games from jail or whatever. But no, when you play old like Super Nintendo ROMs or whatever, and like there's rewind buttons. They also do this in a lot of like modern collections. Like I believe it's an option in some of the sort of like the Castlevania and Contra collections and stuff like that. So
yeah, those have it. The Tomba remaster has it. I've been using a lot of that in my Tomba play because sometimes it just is a pain in the butt to replatform through all that stuff. Like, why am I going to spend 2 minutes reclimbing here when I can spend 3 seconds going back, you know, 5 frames to land the jump.
It got me thinking about those times when you're playing a Soulsborne game and your boss, the boss has one hit left and you have like one hit left, and you do that risk reward and you go to attack him and then he gets you and you die. Would you rewind?
I don't want to burst your bubble, but I think it's a little bit more akin to a traditional rewind button than that. Like, it's, I don't think it's going to be rooted in the gameplay. I think it's more like you would hit this to see accessing recent gameplay while the player is playing video game is difficult and requires hacking an existing service to view the portion of the gameplay of interest. For instance, the player may have to specifically instruct the gaming system to create a file including portions of gameplay for purposes of sharing with other players. The player may have to exit the gameplay in order to create the sharing file. When the sharing file is completed, the player can then access the portion of the gameplay of interest for viewing. So I think it's just
So what it sounds like to me is, so you know how like right now we have that capability when you use the share button to like capture your footage, you can go back up to 60 minutes and record that video. It kind of almost sounds like enhancing that feature to a degree, to where like, I don't know, it's weird because like the share button already kind of does that. It's what it sounds with the description.
Like almost like a replay button. Like you're watching like the football, and then like, you know, like you want to you want to see a play, and then, you know, you're commentating over it. So like, Brian, if you wanted to torture yourself and see yourself get hit by that boss over and over again, I guess you can. Is that what?
Well, yeah, but what if you rewound before you made that bad decision?
I don't think you can rewind the game. I think like some games will allow you to do that, but I feel like that's too complicated. I think it's just you get to view it again. Like it's basically like, what was I doing again? Like if you want to, you know, figure out where a location was or where you saw something, it's you can scrub that back through and be like, where was I doing that?
That would make sense. Like, because if you say are playing a game and it crashes, you can't use the share button to record that footage anymore. As soon as you go back, that game closes for whatever reason, any recording backwards is gone. So maybe this is kind of a fix for that, because there's been a lot of times where I've been like playing a game, recording for like a review, and the game crashes. I'm like, oh, great. But it checkpointed after the footage, after I like got to the point where I wanted, so I can't go back and get that stuff. So if it's a rewind to where I can now go back and retrieve that footage by moving the game back some magical way through tech, that'd be kind of cool.
We're kind of missing the key component here. It says game controller, so that means we're going to be getting a controller that has this built-in feature.
Mm-hmm. Not necessarily. I mean, I don't want to get everyone, you know, worked up here, but like, again, this is a patent. They're throwing it out there. They might never use it. We talked about that like controller that was had like
warm,
so the warm squishy haptic controller.
Yeah, that would change as to based on temperature or whatever, could melt and re-solidify.
It just had like lumpy squishy stuff in it. It just makes silly noises shaped like a boppet, but it's wet. I don't know. No one wants that controller. That's what this is going to be. This is, I could see them sort of tweaking what the idea of a share button looks like. I mean, that was a new addition for the PS4, and I don't know. I feel like they kind of adjust based on how people use it. I could see them sort of tweaking it, maybe renaming it or something. But again, they also might do nothing at all with it whatsoever. And but it's nice to see.
It's a very confusing feature, though. Like, we haven't really broken down what the hell what it could possibly be.
I think it lets you review your gameplay, not replay it. I mean, you can play it back to view it, but you're not physically. Like, it's not
able to jump back in and time.
It's not a quick save.
But here's the thing. Who's asking for this? Why are they patenting this?
I mean,
features away, like quick resume. And you want to give us the damn thing with Adam Sandler on it?
I mean, I think Adam Sandler is actually, I think that was
a great. Adam Sandler are like just making fun of it. Like, not making fun of it, but having fun.
It actually says in the patent that Adam Sandler is in it. He's in the controller. I don't know how that's going to work.
FromSoft won't let us use it no matter what.
No, of course not.
They don't even let us use pause at the time.
I do hope that on some level it does have an interaction where it could be used in games in the future.
That'd be cool. I mean,
you know, to Akeem and Brian's points, like Blinks and Castlevania games have done it and stuff like that. I would love it for it to be like an actual like feature. Like, imagine it takes off and we get a new Beautiful Joe, and that's the button for rewinding the gameplay, like that action in Beautiful Joe.
So I could really see if this does in fact let you like rewind time in the game and then replay segments like interactively, I could see that being one of those features that Sony implements that is like a proprietary PS5 thing, and all the first party games have it, but third party studios are like, we're not doing that.
I do want to point out
they phoned it in, you know.
It's been a while, but Adam Sandler's click, he gets the remote from the Beyond section of a Bed Bath & Beyond where Christopher Walken is working.
You know, I was going to say that this was a stupid thing to talk about so much, but I think you really just tied it together. I think that it's good to have some Beyond discussion here.
And on the poster, he's holding the remote like, is it up, sort of upside down?
It's just a weird remote.
It's just a weird remote. It's right side up for him. The PlayStation logo, I think that we put on there. It's
like holding
again, this is the image that we're showing is not anything from the patent or from Sony. It is the cover of the DVD for the film Click. It does this
we have modified.
Does not involve Adam Sandler. I just want to make that clear. Now, as far as things that Sony has officially announced. There wasn't just some, you know, weird post-it note on a Christopher Walken's Bed Bath and Beyond office. Sony has committed to major single player games coming every year from 2025 onwards, which is nice to hear. I'm guessing this, the only ones we know about right now that are strictly single player are Ghost of Yotei and Insomniac's Wolverine. And I sort of shaky wiggly for Death Stranding too, because the same week that this announcement was made, Kojima also stealth dropped Death Stranding on Xbox and also announced that he was like, the Death Stranding IP was now officially under Kojima Productions properly. Sony is still publishing Death Stranding 2, and I'm guessing that means it'll have a few years of console exclusivity on PS5, maybe PC at the same day, but we'll probably see a cross-platform launch later on.
Yeah, it broke my heart when I saw that stealth drop. It broke my heart. I was like,
Kojima. Why?
But I'm just
why?
Because we lost an exclusive.
My heart just broke because
we didn't lose. I mean, we didn't lose anything. We still had to play the game.
But my heart just broke. I can't explain how I work on the inside. That's just how I felt.
How did you feel when they said Death Stranding was coming to iPad? Because that happened too. That was weird.
Oh, that's right. Did that happen already? That happened. Didn't it come into iOS?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think so.
Yeah. Like, it's been everywhere for a while. Like, that's we're not losing anything there.
Akeem, did a Death Stranding thing stealth dropping confuse you? Because you're supposed to drop things incredibly cumbersomely in that game and then fall down a mountain for 45 minutes.
Nothing drops stealthily in that game.
That's been on iOS. It's 1999 and it's number 18 in adventure, which I don't know what that says about the state of adventuring in iOS games. But anyway, the point is Sony is committing to single player games, which is nice. That's exciting. I'm very glad to hear that, because for a cool minute there, the big sort of marching order was live service. Everything's going to be multiplayer. Hurrah. Look at great stuff, everybody. And obviously that really went well with Helldivers 2 and then really did not go well with Concord. So it's sort of understandable why they'd be reframing expectations. And we've also, I don't know, there've single player games like Black Myth Wukong sold incredibly well, and I think there's an argument to be made that, like, maybe more of that, maybe just make a game that you don't have to play on a live service subscription type model.
Give me everything in the package right off the bat.
Yeah,
I mean, Concord did that anyways, but
make more single player games.
Do you think we're going to see a single player announcement from first? Because Sony's got a handful of studios. There's Ben, there's Media Molecule, there's Naughty Dog. We know what Sucker Punch is doing. There's Insomniac. I mean, we know about Wolverine, but there's probably some other stuff going on over there.
They probably got another Ratchet and Clank.
Yeah, probably. Kicking around. Yeah. Why would they stop making those? And then of Sony Santa Monica. So I guess I want to go around. I want to see what studio you think will see an announcement from first, and what you think that could possibly be. Jada, I want to start with you.
Yeah, I think, okay, there's one I think that will happen, but the one I'm hoping we see happen sooner rather than later is Housemarque. I want to see what Housemarque is cooking up next. Returnal was fantastic. That was what, launch year PS5? Or like the year right after? It was 2021, I think. 2020 or 2021, I can't remember. 2021, because it was like May or April after the launch. So first year of PS5 launch. And they said they're working on something new, something different, something that they haven't, I believe it was said, it was a genre they haven't done before. So I'm very excited to see what Housemarque announces and what they have coming. I think that would be a fantastic way to kind of kick off this new span of a big, you know, single player things. Obviously, we have Yotei next year, which is going to actually kick it off. But I would love to see Housemarque's next game pop up either in the same year or right afterwards in the next year, 2026.
Yeah, I'm always down to play whatever they work on. They make awesome, awesome games. Did you see, side note, did somebody modded Samus into the PC version of that game?
Oh, yeah. That was like, I feel like that was like day one. Yeah, like, that was like everybody was like, just give me Samus.
That's so fun to look at.
Akeem, what studio do you think we're going to see at first, and what do you think they're going to show off?
See, you say up first, but my brain doesn't work logically
that. All right, whatever you want to say, just go nuts.
It's more so what I would want, what I would prefer, and that would be, I would love to see something from Santa Monica Studio, of course. You know, we have, God of War, there's going to be a live action series. We do know that. I think it would be pretty awesome if they announce it. Could be 2 years out. I don't care. I would love to just see an announcement of a God of War, the next installment in the series. even if it's just a teaser, just like a beard, just a close up of Kratos's beard. You know,
that's the studio I have pinned for actually being first outside of Yotei, because of the rumor mill that's been kind of bubbling up about the originals getting remastered. That would still technically classify as a big single player thing for Sony. And we know their penchant for remasters and remakes. So I could definitely see Sony Santa Monica being like kind of leading the pack after Yotei.
Brian, what about you? What do you expect to see? What do you want?
It's been a minute for Naughty Dog. It's been 4 years since The Last of Us Part II. We're heading into 2025. We know that they diverted a bunch of resources into the multiplayer game, which got sort of unceremoniously canceled, last year? Or was that even this year? So they're up to me. Yeah, and I don't want or expect another Last of Us. I know that they talked about, like, they've sort of beaten around the bush about, like, creating another entry in the Last of Us story, right? Whatever that means, or stories in that world. And like, clearly they built a bunch of stuff for that universe for the multiplayer game. And they talked about a lot of it being narrative driven, which is really cool. I think that was a big thing about them being like, this is not just your typical multiplayer game. But there was also that rumor for years about them doing like this, you know, sci-fi thing. Like a third person action game with dragons or something like that. And I think that like the Last of Us Part 1 and 2 are like two of my favorite story driven video games ever made. I think they're just like phenomenal. And I know some people have their beef with the second one. I'm good on Uncharted for a while. Like, I feel like we got a bunch of really good Uncharteds. I loved the spinoff one they did. Uncharted 4 was like a little long in the tooth for me, but I would love to see like a teaser trailer or a logo or a poster or literally anything to let us know that like Naughty Dog is working on something new. And the Game Awards are in like a month, I think to the day almost. Like, yeah, they're like a month from today ish. So I don't know. It feels like that'll be a good time to maybe find out about what they're doing next.
I think so too. And I really hope we're right, because I feel like the running theme with Keighley's big summer of Game Award announcement type stuff is, you know, there's big reveals, but people kind of hype themselves up and we wind up, Sony hasn't been showing off anything themselves. So it's, as far as like big E3 grade drops and announcements, it's been kind of a dry spell. I'm betting on Naughty Dog too. And I think my theory, this is completely based on basically nothing aside from the art that showed up in The Last of Us Part One that was like dragons again. And it was an addition that wasn't there. And they've always been very good about like dropping these little Easter eggs in there in that sort of Pixar fashion where it's like, oh, we're going to tease our next project in this project. I could totally see them coming out, revealing this thing. I think it's going to be a very different tone from The Last of Us, and I would put it more in line with Uncharted. Like, I think that they're probably you really can't get more intense and serious than The Last of Us Part Two. And I imagine they want to bring it back a little bit. I could absolutely see it being this some kind of a, you know, fantasy universe that has just enough of its own individual flair to sort of set it apart, whether that's in the setting or the aesthetics. I don't see it being like a straight conventional Western fantasy. I could see it being more sort of like almost a TV eco kind of thing.
Maybe like a precursor legacy kind of thing, maybe going back to that Jack and Daxter time.
I mean, that would be wild if they did like a modern spin on Jack and Daxter, but
say like Jack and Daxter, but I mean like just kind of like tonally.
I mean,
like
it'd be wild to see that aesthetic sort of given a more grounded approach. Like, what do those characters look like in photorealistic form as rather than cartoony? That would be that would be wild. Again, I could see it being something like that, but I want to say with Naughty Dog, it's going to do the thing where it's just really just turning the quality of writing up to 11. You know, it's not going to be Oscar fodder like The Last of Us, at least tonally, but I could see it being trying to chase, like if it's dealing with sort of, you know, magic, and if it's more adventureful in tone, I want to say it would be like doing throwback Spielberg. I don't know why. I just feel like that's sort of the vibe they would be going for, where there's
dark
elements, but there's kind of like a, I don't know. It's like, I guess fun, more fun than serious, but a bit of both.
I mean, if
maybe the dark eco of Jack 2.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm a big Jack fan. So
no, that's fine. Keep, yeah, sure.
If go you for keep it. Referencing things from the Jack games,
I mean,
I'm gonna keep drawing those lines.
A lot of people who got mad at the leaks for The Last of Us 2 and didn't play it, and I've said this 1,000 times before, and I'll keep saying it until I'm dead, missed out on some of the best and most polished third person action gameplay in any video game ever. Like the way that game scales, the options you have, the maneuverability, the weapons you have, like all of that functions so well. So to like strip the horror elements out of that and the sort of despair and just, I don't know, give me magic attacks and stuff like that and put me in a whole new world. Yes, sure. Like that, like they know what they're doing. They know how to make a properly functioning third person action game on a level that I think few studios do. I will say, though, like in terms of who's actually being next up, like shout out to Sony Ben, because they put out Days Gone in what was it 2017 2018 2019, like, and not no game since. Like they ported the game to PC, and there was rumors for a little while about them becoming like either a port house for a sort of a sister studio, right? Like a sort of coming in as like a support team. But also there was rumors about them working on a multiplayer something or the other. But either way, it's been like we haven't heard of a new product from them this decade. And so by all means, they're up next, because like we've gotten games from Insomniac, we've gotten games from you know, Naughty Dog put out
Housemarque,
and Housemarque, and everybody has put out something for the PS5 at the very least, right? If not even a remaster of their own game. And so like, yeah, I'm dying to see what Bend is working on. I know that they don't have the biggest, they don't have like the same size studio as some of the other ones underneath the, you know, Sony's umbrella here, but like I'm really fascinated to see what they do. I hope they keep making cool stuff forever. And yeah, to me, like they should be up next, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So whenever you're ready, let us know.
I hope so.
I hope we get something new. As much as I love to see sequels, things like that, I would love to see these studios that have made incredible games show off something brand new and just surprise us and give us something new to speculate and talk about for a few years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that we say that, Max, and then we get something like Concord and then no one buys it.
Okay. Well, yeah, so
I blame that on Sony partially. I literally was in our comment section talking about that, because the secret level episode. Creators like talk, they talked about the episode, yep, about or whatnot, and about working with the Concord Firewalk team. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I still think to this day the biggest like miss on Sony's part was not taking this damn game to Gamescom the month of its launch.
Yeah.
How do you not put it in front of hundreds of thousands of players to give them to like change the narrative that it was around this game?
100%. Not only
to like
that,
generate buzz.
Not only that, Jada, but like sitting on it a little bit longer, just letting it gestate, do some more beta mm-hmm. testing. Wait after for this episode to drop. You know, like wait mm-hmm. for this secret level episode to drop. Let's see what the temperature check is on whatever the narrative. Like we don't know what it's going to be, but it, you know, I mean, like Amazon Studio, they have faith in it, and they're still moving forward with it. Let's see what this is going to be about. Let's see what the reception is from the public. Mm-hmm. You know,
before
this universe on us.
I'll be the negative Nancy here and say that I don't think any of these things would have saved Concord specifically. Fair. And I think that's because people are set in their ways on the multiplayer games they play.
I agree.
They go to the same four casinos every single day and they don't want to go to a new one. Like that's basically what it comes down to. And I think that like the entire, you know, and we don't know all of the data on how much money this game cost to make and how long it took to make. You know, there's various rumors about X hundreds of millions of dollars and 8 years and blah, 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 you know, give or take in either direction. But like, I just think it's like, when I hear that Sony says that they're sort of recommitting to single player games again, that makes me happy, because I think that that's more of the kind of thing that they've conditioned their audience for decades now to check mm-hmm. in on and pay attention to and drop the 60, 70 bucks on a year to play. Like these are the kind of things that, you know, like they also have the same tendency to spiral out of control budget wise. You look at, you know, Spider-Man 2, like obviously, cost too much money and didn't make enough money in return. They, you know, like there's negative sides to all of that. But I think that the idea of them putting out a single player game that doesn't necessarily immediately resonate with people, but could over long term, is a better gamble than putting out a multiplayer game that they pull off complete offline completely a week later, and then it goes away for good. Like, you look at Star Wars Outlaws, right? Didn't exactly hit with the biggest, hardest oomph, right? Like, a lot of people were just kind of like tepid about it. You know, some of us here really enjoyed it, but like Ubisoft basically said, like, hey, like, that didn't go well for us. It's actually making us reconfigure the future of our single player games. But like, they just hired a new creative director for that game. Like, that's one of those things that they're committing to holding on to and sticking around for a long time, because they obviously saw there was enough promise there to turn it into something. Whereas like with multiplayer games, it's really, really hard to turn that around. It's really hard.
Yeah, because I think even X Defiant isn't doing as well.
Yeah.
I think it might be ending, if I recall correctly. Mm-hmm. And Sony's no stranger to struggling with multiplayer games on their consoles for a while. Like, does anybody remember playing Mag? I do.
Yeah, I
played the crap out of Mag. I really enjoyed Mag. Did anybody play Starhawk or Warhawk? Those games that were bundled with PlayStations for a while? Like, lots of people did play them, but they just didn't have the longevity because, like you said, Brian, everybody has their favorite, like, casinos that they go to, and they stick with those same casinos. For like, look at Call of Duty. Like, Call of Duty has had major swings in it's a good year, it's a bad year, it's a bad year, it's a good year. Like, it's, but it still sells the most copies almost every year because it is the junk food that everybody is comfortable with. And I say junk food as somebody who enjoys Call of Duty, and I play Call of Duty almost every year. Like, at least the campaign, and like go through prestige once, and then I just put it down.
Yeah.
But like,
I care mostly about the campaign of that. And I think that was, not to bring it back to Concord, but I feel like that's what it was missing. It was missing like some sort of single player aspect so that we can get to know these characters
completely,
you know, and like, well, who are they? Like, you can't just drop, you know, weekly cinematics and expect us to buy in, because we can skip those and just jump right into the, whatever the battle royale is.
Even the I remember, Gene Park, friend of the show, was talking about how just completely crazy it is on a scope level financially to drop weekly cinematics. Like, that is just one of those things. It's, you know, whatever. We don't have to postmortem on this game forever, but I do think that like that game was a good lesson for a lot of companies out there that people are sort of locked into a couple of games. Like, Jada, you went through a whole list of the old classic sort of PlayStation multiplayer games that worked and didn't work. Like, one of the big ones was Rocket League, right? Which was like a PS Plus game. You could very much make an argument that the reason that game is successful today was because that game was so big out the gate on PlayStation Plus. Good time and a place. But also, like, at the time, they weren't necessarily going head to head with, like, you know, half a dozen different
there still isn't anything that's really like Rocket League. It really carved out its own space.
It's also, and it's like Rocket League wasn't competing with FIFA, and it wasn't competing with Forza. Yeah. Like, it was car soccer, but it wasn't trying to like ape either of those styles of gameplay. Concord was trying to do this weird fusion of single player and multiplayer where it's, oh yeah, you get, you know, cinematic drops every you know week or month or whatever to get to know these characters. And like, it just makes me think back to the olden days of multiplayer games when the multiplayer part was kind of that was kind of the bonus crap. Sometimes that was phoned in, but you know, you'd have Half-Life like that, and then it would be Counter-Strike as a sort of a side thing. Like, games would have the single player would be the main focus, and that would introduce you to the characters, and then you jump into multiplayer and like mess around for a bit. But it's completely flipped, and
it's the bottom line. They see, you know, execs see that the dollars that games like Fortnite and Apex and all these other games bring in on a weekly, monthly, yearly basis, and everybody wants to do that. But, you know, there's only so much pie that each company can take up. And when you've got companies that have been around for longer that that have, 60% of the pie at times?
Yeah,
like,
it's a lot of pie.
It's very good pie. What, realistically, what percentage of that pie do you think you're going to steal from those people?
Yeah. And it's like, I think what like is like kind of messing me up about this is that these are the stories that we know about, right? These are the stories that the public knows about. Like, we know about the failure of Concord. We know about the cancellation of The Last of Us Online. We saw leaks of Guerrilla's Horizon multiplayer mode. Who knows where that is or where that isn't. But I do wonder, like, how many of these studios were put on this mandate a couple years ago of like, hey, you know, divert X amount of resources and staff and employees to building us some new casinos. Like how many PlayStation studios were told, like, make a robust online multiplayer thing that people need to check in and do their dailies and all this stuff like that, right? And then they saw sort of a turning of the tide, and they saw that there was a lot of these things did not work for them. Two specifically did not work for them. Two that were probably very, very expensive. I cannot even fathom what it cost to make The Last of Us online multiplayer for several years and then just not even put it out. Like, Concord didn't make any money, right? Like, it had, it sold less than like a,
so they ended up refunding
copies. Yeah, they were refunding copies. So, like, they literally, I don't think they made any money on that whatsoever, except for people who forgot to refund it. But that's more money than The Last of Us Online multiplayer made, right?
Physical copies, I guess.
Yeah, physical copies. But so I do wonder, like, how many of these studios got this, like, call, like, a month or two ago being like, hey, where are we at on that? You don't worry about it. Just scrap it. Things that weren't even publicly announced. Like, The Last of Us Online multiplayer was a publicly announced project. We saw, what, two pieces of concept art, and we heard some interviews about it. We heard about the sort of like the narrative sort of subtext that they were doing to get people playing for a reason, right? It wasn't just run around in circles. It's like, oh, there's a thing happened. Like, we wrote a story around it. All of that went away. And so I wonder, you know, and I can't speak to this because I don't work at these studios, and if I did, I wouldn't leak what they are working on. But I do wonder how many PlayStation studios were told, like, hey, you need to work on a multiplayer game, and then were recently told, don't worry about it. Yeah, I mean, I think that between that and, you know, rising cost of games and the COVID of it all a couple years ago, and then obviously the transition from PS4 to PS5, there's a lot of factors there that would make me think, you know, we might not see something for a while from some of these studios. Like, we don't know if Bend was working on a multiplayer thing. We don't know if Guerrilla was working on a multiplayer thing. Like, we don't really know. Like, there's a chance that those things were in development and could still be happening or are no longer on the table.
Well, so, I hope that in about a month we will get to see what somebody's working on. I think it would be, I think that Keely will have something to show off at the Game Awards, and I hope it's cool. Cause I like it when things are cool. Now something that, we jumped in the community group and we asked everybody who bought a PlayStation 5 Pro, what they actually think of it, because none of us, you know, took the plunge on that. And I'm, you know, generally I feel like shell out $700 for something, you're probably gonna have a good time. You probably thought about it pretty hard. You know, you made an educated decision. So I'm honestly curious what the sort of, you know, is there buyer's remorse? Is there excitement? Is there genuine surprise and wonder? Jada, what did people think of this thing?
Yeah, I mean, there honestly wasn't as big of a response to this community question as I was expecting based on just the initial hype level and everybody who was maybe like unhappy with how we talked about it at first, I guess is the best way to put it. But like, there just wasn't a whole lot of interaction with this post. And like, that's, you know, it's a very small, you know, subsection of the community. But we've got Tony Peterson. I got one. Only game I tried so far with support is Dragon Age. It looks and runs great, but never tried it before to compare. has the 55-inch 4K 120 FPS TV. Feel it's important to mention because I wonder if people without a nice TV will feel as compelled to make the jump. I also had a launch PS5, which was starting to act up occasionally. I would have trouble when I booted it, so it seemed like a great time to make the jump. So like, that's one of those situations where like, for Tony, it like made all the sense to upgrade. Yeah, at this point, you're having issues with your launch console. It's getting, you know, long in the tooth. You're, you know, why not at that point?
Not only that, he has a television where he could technically see like a, you know, all the different enhancements. Like if you just have like a regular like 1080 television, it's honestly, I don't see the purpose of you might as well just use that money to buy a 4K television.
Yeah, I feel like what we've all said and you know, we've been on a little bit of a roller coaster together on this thing, but our immediate reaction was like, what? This isn't, it is too much money. And, you know, I wrote a whole op-ed about how it's too much for too little. And then we boomeranged a little when they had announced the 30th anniversary one. And then we went back to being negative on it when we couldn't get those. And I've just been there.
Me, Brian.
Yeah, that was you and me. But we've been there since, right? Like since that morning when it was like, couldn't add to cart, I've just been like, yeah. Oh, fuck this thing.
I was in a queue for an hour. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, yeah. I was like driving my kid to school. I'm like on my phone, like a, you know, bad dad. And I'm just like, did I get it? Did I get it? Whatever.
Well,
like,
the other funny thing is the anniversary editions aren't out yet. So
no more weeks.
Any sort of buzz that there might be around this thing that's bolstered by people who are getting that, you know, added bonus of nostalgia and this limited edition thing and, you know, showing off photos of it on their Twitter or whatever. That isn't happening. It's like, again, it's this weird separated in the same way that they announced this thing would make you know, bigger shadows or bushes or whatever. And then 3 weeks later, we're like, oh, by the way, here's Ghost of Yotei running on it or whatever. Like they completely have just cut it up into pieces and spread it out. So like, I don't even see there being, again, there's not really much buzz about this thing, which is,
no,
it seems like it's cool, was, but yeah.
That was exactly Cedric Jude Fogout the second. Longest name in the Facebook group.
Not to be confused.
Say it right there. I appreciate that. Lucky enough to get the 30th Pro Anniversary Bundle, but he has to wait the 2 weeks to give impressions. Seems like it might work out, though, since not all games have their Pro patches out yet. That's another thing. Like, PS5's Pro is out, and there's like 50-ish games that have their patches now, but not every game has their patch right now. That's going to take time to get there. So, and that's fine. Nobody expected to turn on the PS5 Pro and everything just be magically patched and updated. Studios are working on 2-3 other things, you know, at a minimum, including, you know, maintaining what other games are already up, working on their next project, R&D, prototyping. There's so much stuff that they're working on. Like, it's like, oh, now we got a patch for this older game that isn't going to make the studio any money. Like, how much of a priority is that for us? Like, it may generate some extra sales if we say, hey, I don't know, Nier Automata, one of my favorite games of 2017, we're gonna you know, put that PS5 Pro patch in there, which I would love,
right?
But like, it's like, are we realistically going to sell more copies on that now than working on the next project or whatever?
Yeah, I feel like anecdotally when the PS4 Pro came out, which I was way more into as a concept than I am for the PS5 Pro this time around. And I think a part of that was I'm not as interested as in replaying some of the PS5 single player games that I've played already, a lot of the first party stuff. But I remember it did get me to buy a bunch of games that got patches just to feel like I was getting something in return for the, you know, what was it, $400-$500 for the PS4 Pro at the time?
$399, I think.
Yeah. So like this time around, like,
I can't remember,
you know, IGN got sent one. We did a full unboxing video of it. A lot of people work at IGN, so it's not like we're all just like, you know, passing that thing around. But I saw like a lot of my friends in the industry getting them, and I didn't even feel that like tinge of like, oh man, I want that. Like it was super weird because it's just not.
You love new things. You love.
I do love new things.
Gadgets. Yeah,
I love new things. I love retail therapy and spending money on things I don't need and all the other dumb crap I shouldn't do. Right. But for this, I was just like, oh, all right. Well, I have, you know, have fun seeing better reflections in Spider-Man 2. I beat that game already. I'm good.
Somebody else in the Facebook group post, I can't pull it up right now, but they posted a side by side of with the slider for, or not a side by side, but a slider for PS5 Pro versus just, I believe, just base PS5 for Bloodborne. Mm. And I was like, I had to sit there for like, I don't know, 3 minutes trying to see what the difference
What's
was. And I finally figured
it
out. And there was like a lamppost that just looked sharper. Like the image just looked sharper. I didn't notice it until I looked at a lamppost and I was like, this is just a little bit sharper. It doesn't have as much of a film over it that, like, you know, which the film almost kind of adds to the Bloodborne kind of vibe with kind of the like misty, foggy kind of like vibe of Yharnam. Right. So like, it's kind of, I was like, these are the same picture. These are the same picture.
I watched that too. And I was like, if there's anything that's going to get like, you know, Jada, you and I have talked for a while about like the one game that might get you in there, right? For you is Monster Hunter. For me, it might be Assassin's Creed next year or Ghost of Tsushima. But I was watching the Bloodborne stuff as well, and I was like, that it's not there yet. And specifically because I've been watching the PC community that is figuring out how to emulate the PS4 version of Bloodborne, and they are making like huge leaps every couple of weeks. And watching that happen, I'm like, Sony, pay them, like hire them to do it. Like,
yeah.
I just saw a video literally this morning about like they got all these like particle and fog effects working, and there's like some, you know, there's some like weird hiccups with like some textures popping in and stuff like that. And like, you know,
I mean, we get that in games anyways.
Yeah, we get that in games anyway, but like it doesn't need a sound mod anymore. There's all this stuff that I'm like, oh, they're making significant progress with this thing. And I have a beefy enough gaming PC that I'm like, do I just hold out? But also, like, if Sony said at the Game Awards, hey, we're making 4K 60 FPS Bloodborne remaster, and it's, you know, it's going to look like this on PS5 Pro, then everything I've said in the last 15 minutes goes right in the toilet, and then I go right into the store and I buy this game. Like, all right, that's what it takes to me. It needs a killer app, right? And it's just not there for me yet.
Yeah. And Bloodborne is a killer app. I love Bloodborne. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to. Oh, wow. I want to play.
You talk about Bloodborne, Brian. It's never going to happen.
Yeah. And every time we say it, they push it internally. They're like, no, sorry, it's not done to three. Put it
one more month.
That's why shout out to the community, because they're the ones doing it.
They're doing
putting
it.
In the work that Sony refuses to.
Now,
final real quick one.
Sure.
I'll jump to Scott Tremper. Played the Alan Wake 2 DLCs, noticeably better looking, had some rough moments in performance mode on base PS5. Didn't even think about it on the Pro. Dead Island 2 also surprised me. Feels way crisper and still runs at 60 FPS. Now playing Dragon Age 2 and it's stunning. I don't know if he's playing Dragon Age 2 or Dragon Age Veilguard as well, but he's the number 2. So, I'm very excited to. When I eventually do get a Pro, I am looking forward to jumping back into Alan Wake, because I really enjoy Alan Wake.
Yeah, that's going to look stunning. Okay, so another, I guess, development of PlayStation hardware that's had sort of a rough launch is the PlayStation VR 2 headset, but it's getting some games these days. Last week, Metro Awakening VR dropped. Seems like it was received fairly well. It's getting like sevens and eights. And then this week we're getting Skydance's Behemoth VR, which looks sort of like a VR God of War, but coupled with Shadow of the Colossus, where you're like fighting regular dudes with axes and stuff, but then climbing much larger dudes and also using axes to fight them. We didn't play either of these, but Akeem, you got a PlayStation VR 2 PC adapter and plugged the
That is right. I plugged
dabbling
it
in arcane technology.
Yes, it really breathed new life into this bad boy. It's currently plugged into my PC. This is the closest it's been to me in months. I'm currently holding my PSVR 2, by the way, for those that are listening.
I can confirm it's a PSVR 2.
It is. It is indeed. Honestly, I feel like I've played more PSVR 2 in just the last week alone than I have like since I've owned this without this adapter. And I think that speaks volumes to the amount of games that, you know, PlayStation has been putting out natively to the PS5. It's been a lifesaver for me. Obviously, everyone knows that Steam has like such a built out catalog of PSV or VR games. Mm-hmm. But the only one that I've been playing the most, believe it or not, is VR chat. I like to interact with other people. That was actually, you know, back in 2020. 2020 is when I really got invested into VR, because, you know, we're all quarantined. You know, we're here alone. We're not able to communicate with our loved ones on a regular basis. So one of my pastimes was jumping into VR chat, meeting new people and just having these conversations with strangers, finding out about their lives and what they're going through. Also generating content, of course, because, you know, as someone who is a video creator.
Isn't VR chat on regular PSVR too?
No, it's only on PC.
Wow. No, okay.
It's only on PC. Yeah.
So you just going in there talking to people and hanging out?
Yeah. You can dress up as, well, not dress up, but you can download any any 3D character in existence. So of course, you know, I put on Winnie the Pooh, Goofy, and the thing that throws people off is I can actually do the voices of these characters. So it's like, hey, what's going on? How you doing there, buddy? Is everything okay? And they're freaking out because they're trying to process why is there a Goofy 3D model talking to me as Goofy? and actually really trying goofy. To engage in conversation.
Are you selling tickets to Disneyland?
No, not really. I just want to know about your life. That's it. So I have serious conversations with these people, but, you know, of course, and it's good because, you know, I'm giving them, and this happened during the pandemic. So everyone's like laughing because like we don't, you know, I don't know. I love to entertain people. And so that was a great way to kind of just pass the time. They're laughing. We're talking about life. I would switch into my regular voice as well. And so I've been able to jump back into it with the PSVR 2 on PC. And man, I can't wait to just explore more games. I haven't played Half-Life Alyx yet. I'm curious to see how that plays out on.
With I love my that you get like an adapter to hook up GPU. this proprietary hardware to the PC and take advantage of its new compatibility, and you play a game from 2014 where you can pretend to be goofy. I don't think you need to pretend to be goofy, man.
It's probably easier. Max, that's all I wanted.
It's easier than dressing up like Goofy and like going to the mall and getting arrested or whatever. So I feel like you're.
Wait, why would I get arrested for just dressing up as Goofy at the mall?
Do you want to find out?
Akeem, do you want the short answer or the long answer to that?
Well, I feel like you just can't do that. Like, or well, I'll put it this way.
Challenge
in my,
accepted.
In my brain, there's one of those scales that's like can't and shouldn't, and they're split in the middle right now. Like, and they both land on don't.
Like, well, that was my Halloween costume last year. And everyone
did you go to the mall?
It. No, silly. To be
okay, because you're talking about a designated day where that's an okay behavior, and you're equating it with just a random Tuesday where you would just go to the mall and be like, "Let's go to the show." Am I a Hollywood. Dog or a cow?
There are dudes that are dressing like, you know.
That's true. Goofy. LA has
around, you know the Boulevard. You kidding me?
No, I know. I was in Vegas for work for a week ago, and I saw like, you know, just the filthy Spider-Man and, you know, Bluey that had rabies. Like, yes, it happens. I get it. I totally get it. But that's like a designated place for that. Like, if you just go to the mall dressed like Goofy, set a timer. I'll put it that way. Go to the mall dressed like Goofy, set a timer, see what happens.
I'm actually going to do this weekend. I'm going to get a camera guy. I'm actually going to do this legit.
All right. I don't think that's a legit thing to do. I think it's extremely legitimate of behavior to have, but okay, go on.
I do have a Goofy costume, yes. Okay. I have a 3D printed schnauzer and everything.
A schnauzer?
Don't call
Isn't
it that
what they call it? I don't know. What do you call the thing on his mouth? Yes,
his mouth? Like a mask. His nose. Or his nose.
It's his entire lower half of his face.
I think it's like,
is that a schnauzer?
Technically like his mandibles. Mouth and jaw, technically.
I don't think it's
He's a dog. I'm calling it a schnauzer.
A schnauzer. Okay, so Goofy schnauzer. You know what? I don't know where I expected that conversation to go, but that it wasn't the mall in a Goofy costume, that's for sure.
I'm just trying to get the PSVR 2. It's now optimized for PC.
Hook up the PSVR 2 to your PC and then leave it there and get in your car and then take a Goofy costume and schnauzer out of your trunk and go to the mall and talk to people as Goofy.
Or go to do it in VR chat and you could probably still wind up on a list, but a different one, I guess.
It's a lot safer.
There's a brand new game coming to malls near you. It's called Fuck Around and Find Out.
But no, I'm going to be jumping into Metro Awakening and Behemoth this weekend. So I'll be able to talk about those next week.
Well, good. I'm glad to hear it again. Okay.
That was a roundabout way of saying all of that. Yeah.
You think they'll let you do that from jail?
All right.
We'll find out.
You're both going to podcast jail right now. Jada, you are. Jada, you reviewed Horizon Adventures, Lego Adventure, Lego Adventures of Horizon.
Lego Horizon Adventures.
What is it? How is it?
It's good. It's very good. My review will be live by the time everybody's watching this. I gave it a 7 out of 10. It is very good. It does some really cool, interesting things that a lot of Lego games don't. But it also is lacking on a little bit of that extra content that Lego games also generally offer. So things like a cheat menu or a wide cast of characters or unlocking, you know, silly things like 8-bit music or hidden, you know, having cool puzzles and things you have to solve and stuff.
They got rid of the cheat menu?
Yeah, there's no cheat menu in.
What?
At least that I have found. I haven't found it. It took me 21 hours to get the platinum trophy, 12 hours to finish the campaign. But there was no spot I've seen for a cheat menu. There's nowhere to rewatch like the cutscenes and the videos. There's no way to replay old missions.
So what do those gold bricks do then?
The gold bricks are, so both the gold and red bricks now, and I'm gonna, this is gonna sound like we're kind of getting into the negative portions of my camp of the review. Okay.
But I've played all these games, so like this, that's the kind of stuff that I love.
Yeah, so like the gold bricks and red bricks now are kind of relegated to unlocking various costumes or town customizations, because there's the town of Mother's Heart, which is kind of your hub world that if you've played Horizon Zero Dawn, you'll recognize Mother's Heart. It's that kind of first village you visit that, you know, Aloy gets cast out of because she's different, blah, blah, blah. Well, she's a baby, but whatever. Anyways, so you get to customize and do a lot of stuff in there. And there's a lot of really cool customization. The customizations, I think, are by far kind of like the best, one of my favorite things about this game, because there's so many different costumes. You can dress up as all the different Ninjago characters. There's they have the whole amusement park theme. So you can dress up as like a circus worker. You could dress up as a hot dog, a chicken, all types of really weird things. And that's all fully reflected as you're going through the story. So like, in this game, Aaron, if you remember Aaron, he's one of Aloy's friends. He has a big hammer. He has an obsession with donuts. And so I dressed him up like a chef for most of the playthrough because it just seemed to make sense for him to be dressed as a chef. Varl, the one of the other Nora hunters, one of Aloy's other friends who's also there, he has a penchant for comic books and superheroes in this, and one of his idols is Hot Dog Man and the sidekick Hot Dog Dog. So I dressed him up as a hot dog for a good chunk of the campaign. Like, so I was just going through Horizon, you know, in random costumes constantly, and it just kind of, it's tonally, it's all humor. It's just a lot of fun. The writing is excellent. I was laughing from start to finish. Some of the jokes are a little corny, but they still had me chuckling, and it just gets amplified when you have them wearing these super ridiculous costumes. Combat is great in this game. It's there's 5 difficulty settings, from story mode up to hero. Really like challenge, puts some good challenge in it. It's not Elden Ring difficulty, obviously, it's a Lego game, but you still die in 1 to 2 hits, which is kind of Elden Ring-ish. And so going into, you know, some of these fights and stuff, you're like, if you weren't prepared or didn't have the right gadgets, sometimes made fights a lot trickier than they were. They've got the whole focus mechanic where you can target specific body parts and knock things off for extra experience, or drops for other items you can use.
Jada, did
there's a lot of really cool stuff in this. The combat's really good.
It was like a revive for local co-op. Is that a thing?
Yeah. So in local co-op, you can revive. So that's another thing. I'm torn if it's better or worse than other Lego games, because correct me if I'm wrong, but in other Lego games, when you die, you basically just kind of blink out, you fall apart, you lose some studs, and then you rebuild, and then you continue going. Horizon doesn't do that. In Horizon, if you die, and if you're playing co-op, both people die, it takes you back to the beginning of the area of that zone. They're very small zones, so it's not like you're losing a lot of progress, but it does, you know, it's like a 10, 15, 20 second walk back to the arena if you're dying multiple times.
Sure.
But you retain experience because this one's more of an RPG. So you level up and get more health, more damage, a bunch of other really cool things that you can augment your play style with.
Jada, I got to ask you, what's the goal here? I'm kind of curious. Does this take place between like the first or second game? Like where, like
this is original story? It's a playful retelling of the first game.
Gotcha. Okay.
So it is basically Horizon Zero Dawn. It's in my review, I think it's like my kickoff to my review. It's basically the movie version of a book that you've read and liked. Gotcha. Like it's got the big moments, it's got the characters you like, but it changes some events. It takes some liberties with events and how things play out and the dialogue and stuff like that. It changes all those little things, but the core story is still there. It still has, you know, Aloy and her search for where she came from, her origin story kind of thing. It's got that kind of element.
It kind of reminds me of, I mean, from what you've told me, kind of reminds me of, you know, back in the day when you'd get a licensed game that's based on a movie. And it's kind of like that,
but it's done in Lego form. And I think it's kind of it's great. I really enjoyed that aspect of it. It just was missing some features and stuff that I was really hoping to like kind of carry it longer through playing, because once I finished everything, I was kind of like, well, that's it. That's kind of, I'm kind of done. And I guess that, you know, you can say that about most games. But I feel like with other LEGO games, when I've rolled credits, I feel like there's always so much more stuff to do. And I felt like this one kind of fell shorter in that aspect. Almost all the original voice actors are back. So Ashley Birch, John Hopkins, John McMillan, they're all back reprising their roles and they're fantastic. I think this is probably some of my favorite work from Ashley Birch because she is really diving into that Tiny Tina energy, that, hey, Ash, what you playing? Very just chaotic, fun, but still maintaining that voice of Aloy and just having a really good time with it. And all the characters are doing that. The only character that didn't work for me, unfortunately, is Silence. They recast Silence, obviously, because Lance Reddick passed away last year.
Right.
And they brought in a new voice actor, and it's a very well-known actor. It's Tim Russ of Star Trek Voyager fame. And it just didn't work for me. And like, Silence has always been a more reserved character in the Horizon franchises, but he's very has a very sharp wit. Mm-hmm. Anytime you've talked with them, and he's very like very quick to clap back and have these really like just snarky comments that are like all like just kind of commands your attention when you're talking to him. And in this one, it just fell a little flat for me, unfortunately. Now, I don't know if Tim Russ is.
Yeah,
it's huge shoes to fill. And like, I'm personally glad he didn't try to play it the same as Lance Reddick, because I think it would have come across even worse. Mm-hmm. Because you're imitating, and like, he tried to make it his own thing. It just, this version of Silence didn't work for me. They did make him a DJ in the post-apocalypse, which is kind of fun and kind of cool. And so I really liked a lot of the character quirks of him. I just didn't like a lot of the dialogue and cutscenes with him. It just kind of fell flat for me.
So you've mentioned a lot of like comedy attached to the characters and rooted on the characters. Mm-hmm. Based on the gameplay that I've seen of this, I haven't really noticed quite as much humor in the world around you. Like in the, I don't know, the other LEGO games I play, you know, you go mm-hmm. around a corner in the Death Star and there's like, you know, stormtroopers building a bunk bed or something, or like somebody's having a pizza party, that kind of thing. Is there still stuff like that scattered throughout?
There's a little bit of that. So like the characters, a lot more, the characters are a lot more talkative, like the actual player characters, whoever you're playing as. So like Tirsa, the village elder, she uses bombs. If you pick up freeze bombs, she like while walking around, she's like, oh, it's about to get all frozen wilds up in here, which is obviously the expansion for the first game. And it's like, and there's a bunch of those little types of quips and stuff.
Interesting.
That happens with the characters in your party. There's not as much environmental characters. That's where I was kind of getting in with the level design being a little too predictable. Gotcha. It's kind of explore for like 30, 45 seconds, minute, plays and it, then jump straight, into a fight. Yeah. Explore again, jump into a fight. There's no like hidden areas. There's sometimes like vines that you need to burn in the environment to find like a chest. But the only thing you're getting out of chests are studs or the potential like items to use in combat, which are like rare weapons like ice arrows or a fire spear, things like that. And so like it didn't really reward exploration. And if you didn't have a fire weapon around one of those like kind of leafy walls, you're just kind of SOL. You just couldn't get to that chest. And item handouts are all randomized, so you never know what you're going to get. Even the skill tree lets you get a random item at the start of every level, but you don't know what you're getting, so you don't have like any control over it.
Oh, that's annoying.
Now granted, there's four characters, so like you can swap between those characters at the start of each stage and choose who you want to play as if they have that element that you want or a type of item you want. So there's good freedom in there. And there is some like other ways to like ensure items. There's like a merchant that pops up in each stage about halfway point that gives you like three chests full of items to give you, you know, chance at other different things. And none of the items are bad. Let me put it that way. None of the items are bad. They're all really good items, but it's just a matter of when you're trying to do something specifically, like play as a red Ninjago character and kill enemies with fire damage, not being able to select, okay, I want to go in with a fire bow right now. SOL.
Okay, so wait till next level. It is interesting that they frame this as LEGO Horizon Adventures and not LEGO Horizon. I guess Adventures kind of add some context where, because it's always been Zero Dawn or Forbidden West. But we're also comparing it to the TT games, who, as far as I know, didn't really have anything to do with this. Like this was
correct.
Yeah, which is, and again, they should know that. Because there's been like 20 years of LEGO games that have like sort of an expectation surrounding them.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, this more, the more I look at this, the more it reminds me of Sackboy's Big Adventure, which was not a full blown Little Big Planet game. And again, those were something that people had kind of come to expect. But I feel like in the naming, they kind of established that. Whereas in this case, it doesn't seem like a full fledged Lego game, and it's obviously not a full fledged Horizon game. It's just somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. And it does. But the areas where it exceeds really well. It's just, I say this in my review, like there's going to be obvious comparisons to other Lego games. It's just, it's inevitable. Like it's going to happen regardless, because the visuals of it alone are going to make any kid picking this up is going to be like, why doesn't this Lego game do what Lego Batman does or Lego Marvel?
I mean,
does?
Conversely, like, if some kid who loves Ninjago gets this for Christmas and hasn't ever played anything, they're probably going to lose their mind and they're probably going to get into Horizon. And then they find out that, oh, hey, there's two more games that I can check out at the age of 13 or whatever that the ESRB recommends. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, no. But yeah, like I really did really enjoy it. I had a lot of fun with it. It just left me wanting more, which is kind of the state of, that's kind of like in my, when I go to review games, that's kind of where good generally falls. Good or great is like this, everything it does really well, but it doesn't have enough there. It doesn't go deep enough into these things. I wanted it to go deeper and have more just for me to explore more, to have fun with. There's some cool challenges that, you know, have you like do things like go through a level dressed as a chicken without dying once. And so like, that's kind of cool. Like they put these little kind of like modifiers and stuff into to earn more gold bricks and such. And then there's apex hunts, which are stronger monster machines to fight and tougher battles. And that's, you know, where you'll find like, you know, a corrupted thunder jaw and stuff like that. You'll have to fight. And those are really good. But again, you can't replay those fights after you do them. You have to start a whole new file if you want to replay those. Weird. And that was just a real bummer. Finishing the game, they add what are called expeditions, where you basically just kind of traipse through entire level sections, but you don't know what's going to be in there. It's randomized, so that's kind of cool. So you never know. It kind of keeps things different. But, you know, if you're like, man, I really want to fight a Thunderjaw, can't do that. Like in Horizon, like on the map, it's like, hey, this is a Thunderjaw like location, you can go here and fight a Thunderjaw anytime you want. So I think it's a really good base and foundation from the build upon. I think if we do get a Lego Horizon Adventures 2, which is seems you know, depending on if this one does well enough, it seems like the tech is there, the foundation's there, it could really grow into something great. And I'd like to see that, because there's more, even more stuff they could include from Horizon 2 that would be a lot of fun. Forbidden West,
cool. I should say. Well, Jada, thank you for filling us in on that. And yeah, it sounds more or less exactly like what I thought it would be. I'm sure that, you know, people who are into Horizon and want something smaller would get a kick out of it. And, you know, at least it is a video game coming out this fall that is a new video game that is made by PlayStation. So there's that, you know, it's just something. Thank you all for hanging out. This has been a blast. We'll be back next week with lots more to talk about. We are getting to the holidays, so some of the discussions may get weird as we do sort of evergreen stuff to fill in the gaps for outages. But we will have some fun stuff in store nonetheless. And on that note, beyond.
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 Beyond.